Hey guys. Now we all know, for better or for worse, social media has had a profound impact on the angling community and on fisheries themselves. And right now, I feel like we're right on the edge of another technological leap that's going to have severe implications for the angling community and will have, of course, cascading impacts on fisheries themselves and the sport as we move forward. And this is artificial intelligence. And it seems crazy to be talking about this, but I mean, here we are. There are multiple companies, including some of the really big tech companies like Google, are all coming out with their own versions of artificial intelligence, chat, and photo, art, and video-based programs that will allow you to interact with artificial intelligence for free or for some set cost, and will allow you to very quickly generate content or gain access to vast quantities of information, condense it down into a very human-like written format. And today, what I thought I would do to sort of put this to the test is I logged into OpenAI's latest ChatGPT, which is their version 4, so that's the latest version of their artificial intelligence chat program, which you can type an inquiry into, and then it goes out and gathers up vast amounts of information, looks at publications, blogs, all kinds of information, Wikipedia, everything it can find, and hoovers up all this information and then generates a response in a very human-like form. And I wanted to have a conversation with this AI about Kokanee fishing, because Kokanee fishing is something I'm very confident in. I feel like I am an expert in it, and I would be able to spot poor information or a poor reply. And I just wanted to see how well it measured up. Did it really stand up to what I thought it should in terms of accuracy and of the information and helpfulness? And the results are both amazing and somewhat terrifying as a content producer myself. But this is the future, and I think it's good that we start having conversations about the quality of this information and how useful it is, and also its implications in the long run. So here, this little bit of artwork, I just asked one of the, there's many different art based AIs available online you can log into, and I just told it to give me a robot fishing for kokanee on a mountain lake, and that's what it gave me. So there you go. Looks like that fish might be a little bit spawned out. So one of the first things I wanted to do was just to see if AI knew the difference between a kokanee and a sockeye salmon, because that is a subtle nuance within scientific literature. They're actually the same species. They just have very different life cycles in terms of where they spawn and live their adult lives. And it did a very good job here. You can see when I put in what's the difference between sockeye salmon and kokanee, what it likes to do is it likes to break things down into a bulleted format, which is very good if you're writing a blog or something like that. And humans tend to do better when things are broken into categories. So it discusses the life cycle differences here. So sockeye salmon are anadromous, meaning they're born in freshwater and then migrate into the ocean to feed and grow and return to spawn, whereas kokanee, it says, are a freshwater form of sockeye salmon that spend their entire lives in lakes and rivers. So it got the whole difference between species and forms correct here. It even goes on into much greater detail than I anticipated it would. It talks about size, how sockeye, anadromous sockeye, tend to be larger, and most kokanee are between 1 and 5 pounds. It also talks about the quality of the flesh. It says that sea-run sockeye tend to have brighter red flesh, and kokanee have a lighter pink color. I would say that's generally true. It also talks about taste, saying that the sea-run fish tend to be more oily rich and have a buttery and flavor with firm texture, and that kokanee have a generally mild flavor. That's definitely true when I'm comparing the sockeye that I harvest out of the Columbia River. And then it talks goes on a little bit more about how sockeye are targeted both by commercial and recreational anglers, but kokanee are mostly just a recreational-based fishery. That is amazing. I mean, that is a mind-blowing amount of information from a simple question, and all of it is good. It astounded me that that's what its response was for my first question. So next, I followed up just what is the best way to catch a kokanee? And quite literally, if I needed to write a blog on catching kokanee, I could just copy and paste this into a magazine or a blog, and it would be pretty good. It gave me 6 points. There's some inaccuracies here, and we'll talk a bit about those. But the first thing it wants to give you is it gives you a summary of what kokanee are in response to what is the best way to catch a kokanee. It says kokanee are freshwater salmon. We found in lakes and reservoirs throughout North America. They're popular because they're delicious and have a challenging fighting ability. Yeah, that's a great human-like introduction. And it gives you, here are some of the best ways to catch kokanee. First, use the right gear. So they're caught on lightweight fishing gear. That's true. Now, it suggests using spinning rods and small spinning reels. I would say most kokanee anglers are using small level wine line counters and light monofilament fishing line. Small hooks, such as 4 or size 6. So it gives you hook size and a small lure or bait, which then leads also into when to fish. It says fish during the right time of the day. They like low light periods and late afternoon, evening. That's true. Kokanee are very crepuscular. They do tend to move deeper in the day, which is what it says. So fishing at dawn or dusk can increase your chances of catching fish. Look for schools of kokanee. Kokanee tend to school together in numbers. Look for areas in the reservoir where there are schools of fish feeding near the surface or near the bottom. Okay. They can be suspended too. So that's pretty generalized information. It recommends using a downrigger. Yes, that is good advice. It says kokanee are attracted to small lures such as spinners, spoons that mimic their prey. You can also use maggots, worms, or corn. So, also not terrible information. That's actually quite accurate. I really like number 6. Be patient. Kokanee can be finicky and may not bite right away. Be patient. Keep trying different depths, lures, and baits until you find what works. Yeah, that's a great way to wrap up a very brief overview of kokanee fishing is to sort of give yourself a like generalized amount of space. It's something very human-like to do. So I followed up with what is the best bait for kokanee, and what's interesting is it took interpreted bait to include lures, which was going to be my follow-up anyways. So intuitively knew to tie bait and lures together. It does give you a brief sort of summary at the beginning of each response, and says kokanee are primarily plankton feeders, which is true, so you want to use small lures that mimic the plankton they eat. And number one, it recommends hoochies, which, yeah, of course. I mean, that's a good, great go-to lure for kokanee fishing. It even gives you color recommendations. Bright pink, orange, and red are popular choices. They're typically rigged behind a dodger or flasher trolled slowly through the water. Yes, this is correct. Wedding ring lures is its number two choice. That's also very solid, and it describes what a wedding ring is and how it's trolled. Recommends small spoons. Again, sticking with those same colors, although here it adds in green. It also notes that you can vertically jig small spoons in the water column to catch kokanee. And then it adds a couple of bait, like the real, like what I consider bait, down at the end. It talks about corn, and it also suggests adding scent to your corn to increase its effectiveness. Just super crazy that it's so detailed. And then also talks about maggots. And it goes into the differences between spikes and maggot or mealworms, which is pretty specific. But yeah, it does a very good job here. So my next follow-up was what hook style and brand is the best for kokanee fishing? And the ChatGPT kind of gives you a little bit of a snobbish response when you ask about best for anything, because it's like, well, I'm just a computer, and that's an opinion, right? But it gives you its best answer that it can. When it comes to hook style and brand for kokanee fishing, there are several factors to consider. Here are a few things to keep in mind. Hook size, number one. Kokanee is smallmouth, so it's important to use small hooks. Size 4 to 8 are commonly used kokanee fishing. that's accurate enough, although I do use size 2s quite a bit. Hook style. It recommends octopus style hooks, bait holders hooks, and egg hooks. Strangely enough, on number 3, though, it talks about barbless hooks. And some areas, barbless hooks are required for kokanee fishing. If I would have seen this like just a few weeks ago, I'd have been like, I don't really know that many barbless kokanee fisheries. But then I literally just had a follower from Canada asking me questions about barbless kokanee fisheries, which apparently they have up there. And then as far as brands, it gives you recommendations: Gamakatsu, Owner, Daiichi, and Musted. Okay, yeah, I mean, Owner and Gamakatsu are probably the two big, the big names there in the game. And then it says color. There are also some anglers who prefer to use colored hooks such as red, pink, or green when targeting kokanee. They can make the hook more visible in the water and add an extra element of attraction. Yes, that is true. That's great information. And then I love the caveats at the end. Like, it's just so human-like. Ultimately, the best hook style and brand for kokanee fishing will depend on personal preference and specific body of water you're fishing in. It's good to experiment with different hooks to see what works best for you. Yes, that's true. Okay, so these are, to me, these are really, like, for a artificial intelligence that has access to all of the published materials that it does and forums and Wikipedia and everything like that, I feel like these are really easy. This is like softball. I'm just lobbing them real easy hits. Now I wanted to see how good is this at giving me specific fishing intel for particular lakes. So I asked it, where can I catch kokanee on Lake Chelan? So it starts off by saying Lake Chelan in Washington State is known for its excellent kokanee fishing. Here are a few places you should try. Number one, the Yacht Club. The Yacht Club is a popular fishing spot on Lake Chelan, located on the south end of the lake. Anglers often fish near the Yacht Club marina, trolling with dodgers and hoochies in depths of 6,200 feet. Yes, that is true. Rocky Point is another popular kokanee fishing spot. Anglers often fish between Rocky Point and Wapato Point area, with dodgers and hoochies in 60 to 100 foot of water. Yes, that is also true. The Narrows. The Narrows is a narrow section of Lake Chelan in the middle of the lake where the water depth drops off steeply. Anglers often fish near the Narrows with dodgers and hoochies targeting kokanee in 100 to 150 feet of water. Yeah, that's true. Wapato Point is a popular recreational area on the south shore of the lake. It's a good spot for kokanee fishing. Yes, in fact, that is my favorite spot to go. And Manson Bay is located on the north shore of Lake Chelan. It's a popular spot for kokanee and rainbow trout fishing. Anglers often fish the area near the Manson Bay Marina, trolling with dodgers and hoochies in depths of 60 to 100 feet. Yes. I would say there's probably like 6 or 7 trolling lanes or trolling hotspots on Lake Chelan, and just nailed about 5 of those 7. That is amazing. I mean, to basically go on and find this information, you would have to normally slew through a lot of different forums and groups and ask questions. And this, in about 10 seconds, generated essentially a map of the best fishing areas for kokanee fishing on Lake Chelan. And it also told me how deep to fish and what structures and areas to look for, as well as the lures. That is amazing. Then, of course, the caveat paragraph at the bottom. These are just a few examples of places to fish. It's always good to consult local fishing reports and local experts to get up-to-date information on where to fish and what tackle to use. It's really good. Like, if I wanted to write a blog on fishing Lake Chelan for kokanee, I could have used the first couple questions just to line out the basics of kokanee fishing and then put this paragraph in here on the best fishing areas. And I could have written like a 3,000 word blog on kokanee fishing on Lake Chelan in about 45 seconds. That's terrifying and amazing. All right, so one of the things was this, okay, well, location's easy, but what about current, like, depth? Like, get really specific. So here I asked, how deep are the kokanee on Lake Roosevelt in spring? So this is like getting really specific. We're talking seasonal depth data on kokanee on a specific lake. And its response is, in spring, Kokanee on Lake Roosevelt can be found at varying water depths depending on factors such as water temperature, light levels, and food sources. That's true. However, as a general guideline, Kokanee on Lake Roosevelt in the spring are typically found in the top 20 or 30 foot of the water column. Yes, that is true. I don't know of a lot of resources where that's been written, but it knew the right answer. And that is amazing. And then it goes on with more detail. As water temps warm up in the spring, Kokanee will move towards the surface to feed on the plankton, which is often most abundant in the upper layers of the water. It's a good idea to use a fish finder or depth finder to locate schools of Kokanee and adjust your fishing depth accordingly. That's good advice. In addition, pay attention to any signs of activity on the surface, such as jumping fish or feeding birds. I don't think I've ever used birds for Kokanee on Lake Roosevelt, but I have used them elsewhere. I've definitely used birds to find Kokanee on some lakes, as this can indicate where Kokanee are located. So, yeah, I was fairly stunned that it was able to give me basically seasonal depth data on Kokanee on a specific lake. A lake that, mind you, that there's not a lot of publications about. I'm not sure where it draws all of its data from. I know it can't draw data from videos, and you have to think about a lot of fishing content out there is video based, especially the more recent stuff. But it's still somehow either finding or inferring from other resources that Kokanee are feeding shallow in the spring on Lake Roosevelt, which is pretty amazing. And then I finally got it. I finally tricked. I don't know if I tricked it, but I just caught it in a lie, I guess I'll say. I said, what lakes have the biggest Kokanee? And its general response, of course, is that they're found in many lakes throughout North America, but some are known to produce larger Kokanee than others. Number one, Kootenai Lake, British Columbia. That's true, or used to be true. It still has a pretty big Kokanee fishery, like the world record was from there for a time before Wallawa kicked it off the top of the list. And the west arm of the Kootenai still produces really big fish, but not like it used to. But it does have Kootenai Lake on there, and yes, it has produced extremely large Kokanee in the past, so I'll give it that one. Lake Pendere. No. I mean, occasionally gives you a decent sized Kokanee, but that Kokanee fishery went through a crash and then bounced back, but they've never really been large. There's lots and lots of small fish there. I fished it. Priest Lake. This deep lake in North Idaho is producing Kokanee that reach up to 20 inches long and 3.5 pounds of weight. It is making a comeback. There are bigger fish in there, but I wouldn't consider it one of America's best or North America's best large Kokanee fisheries. But there are decent sized fish in there. Lake Chelan. This deep, clear lake in central Washington is known for producing Kokanee that reach up to 4 pounds. No. You're lucky to catch a green label herring or bigger size Kokanee out there, I feel like, most years. It's a dink lake, like many lakes in Washington state. It just does not produce large Kokanee consistently. It has in the past produced some fish upwards 16, 18 inches in places, but for the most part, they're pretty small. And then it puts Lake Tahoe. This large deep lake on the border of California and Nevada is home to Kokanee that reach up to 19 inches long and 3 pounds in weight. It does occasionally produce large fish, but again, the sort of trophy Kokanee lakes, I wouldn't put, maybe keep Kootenai on this list, but I'd be looking more at like Kalamalka Lake in BC for big Kokanee, Lake Roosevelt, Flaming Gorge didn't make it on there. Fontanelle, Fish Lake. There's a lot of lakes producing much larger Kokanee more consistently than these five. So I think this is in part due to the fact that it is limited to text sources. And like I said, a lot of recent fishing content is generated by video. And mostly I learn about these large Kokanee fisheries through video content, not through written form. I think, you know, written form is dying off, and it's a lot of magazines don't make their articles publicly available anymore. So on, especially online, you got to pay for subscriptions. And so I'm assuming that the chat doesn't have access to that data. So I think some of the information in here is fairly dated, especially when I started like digging into like brand recommendations. It's really going back to like tying in heavily to some of the older brands that have been around for a long time, like Max and Lura Jensen and things like that. And you don't see much mention of the really big brands of today, like Rocky Mountain Tackle, Paulina Peak, and some of those brands like that. So, or Yakima Bay, any of those, they're just not showing up in the ChatGPT. But it's, you know, something to be aware of as a user on this is that some of the information is going to be a little bit dated. But some of those things, like that information that is timeless, like in terms of techniques and depth, it seems to hold up to really well. So that sort of brings us full circle to the end of this discussion. I am one, like I said, I am amazed at how accurate this data was, or and the manner in which it's presented is really easily digestible and readable and understandable. It's also slightly terrifying as someone who produces content for a living. I don't do a ton of written content, but I do some. And using a program like this, somebody who has absolutely zero phishing experience could generate a ton of written content, especially companies and such. So who knows what the future holds, especially as we move towards more AI-generated photography and videography, what the future holds in terms of being able to separate expertise from just regurgitated AI content. It's going to be a challenge. It's going to change phishing. I'm sure that certain companies will start capitalizing on ways to make their companies show up higher in the response rates on when you ask about what to use, where. I'm sure that there'll be opportunities, especially with Google testing it, for companies to pay more to be higher ranked within the output of these AI-based chat search engines. And it's really going to have a pretty profound impact on the end user. I guess the one thing, the one saving grace is that without people like myself and others who truly have in the field experience and expertise writing things up and putting them out on the internet, there's no way for these AIs to get smarter and get better information unless they have access to experts putting real world data into or onto the internet. Anyways, love to hear your responses and thoughts on this video. I feel very conflicted about this because I love technology, and I think it can do a lot of good. I know I've helped a lot of people and I've connected with a lot of people, and it's been a really positive thing. But at the same time, there's plenty of negative things about social media, and I think there will be plenty of positive outcomes with AI, but also potentially negative ones. Anyways, I'll see you next time out on the water. Just remember, fish smarter, not harder. Bye, guys.